Number two is David Fincher's Zodiac, and this came out in 2007. And I think that this is probably his best film, or it's definitely my favorite. It's a really close one between Social Network and Zodiac. But the reason I love this one so much is because to me it is a more mature, more tame version of a lot of his earlier work. When I think David Fincher, I think of movies like Seven, another really, really great movie that I love. I also think Fight Club, Panic Room. So they're these B movies that are made in a much more, with a lot of great quality, I think. But you see a lot of the same themes, as you do with many directors. But with Fincher, it constantly is the idea of cynicism, the perversity of the human fascination with perversity, and kind of the cynicism and the decline of society, outcasts, and that sort of thing. But this one is not nearly as grotesque as Fight Club or Seven, and it's less literal. It's more nuanced. I think it has a much more, as I said, more mature, just a more mature style, I guess is really what I'm trying to say. But what I think is really, really great about this movie is that it's made in the style of a big kind of Hollywood old-fashioned movie. It's very classical. It looks kind of film noir. It's got aspects of thrillers, of horror movies, and it's just really interesting. But it really recognizes the classical conventions of the filmmaking because, yes, it's done in a Hollywood style, but the story is a true story. But you would never know that unless it probably said so. Because the idea, of course, it's about the Zodiac Killer, and the Zodiac was so outrageous. I mean, he had the gimmick of every time he would kill somebody, he would leave the Zodiac sign, or he would leave a letter for the detectives, for the police, and just little clues here and there, as if he wanted to be caught, or he was kind of toying with the police and toying with the citizens and things like that. And this sort of thing you don't ever see, or you rarely see in the world. It's usually seen in a comic book or in a movie. So he's blurring the lines between what we see as these big kind of fantasy stories and what is in real life. And sometimes there's very little difference. And the main character, the story is, I mean, there's about three people, a detective, a journalist, and a cartoonist who is just really fascinated by the Zodiac. But in the latter half of the film, Jake Gyllenhaal plays the cartoonist who's really interested in the Zodiac. He starts to really want to find out about Zodiac, even though it's been years since he's had another killing or anything like that. And he talks to a detective played by Mark Ruffalo. And Mark Ruffalo says, "Well, you know, there have been many, many crimes in the city, in the world, that are much worse than what Zodiac did. I mean, Zodiac, of course, did horrible things, but he killed just a few people. Think about the millions of deaths that have happened since then." But Jake Gyllenhaal is just so fixated and obsessed with the perversity of this villain that, you know, it really doesn't matter. I mean, it's basically saying that sometimes our fascination with the grotesque or criminals that are insane sometimes can get in the way of things that are more important, and I think that's very interesting. But aside from that, I mean, really just the characters are very interesting. The writing is just spot on, it's great, and of course the direction is out of this world. And some of the killings in this movie are just so suspenseful and so interesting. I could watch them over and over and over again. And again, there have been some criticisms of this movie as well. A lot of people think that the ending isn't satisfying. And again, I couldn't disagree more. I think that what this movie is doing is capturing a sense of paranoia and tension in a way that it really doesn't matter if you don't have a satisfying conclusion, because in life, sometimes things aren't neat and tidy and you don't get the solution that you're looking for. And it makes the film all the more haunting, I think, and all the more kind of creepy at the end of it to think that things just didn't happen the way that a lot of us wish it could have. So, if you're a David Fincher film, this is a must. This one, I think, I recommend probably more than any of the others just because it's so underrated. The movie came out, as I said, in 2007. It really just didn't do that well in theaters, and it's just one of Fincher's lesser-known works, but I think it's amazing. So, if you're a Fincher fan, this is one that you have to see. Again, severely underrated. And my number one, my favorite film of the last decade is There Will Be Blood by Paul Thomas Anderson, and it came out in 2007 as well. This is a very different film experience. And when I say that, this is probably the best example I can think of when I think of an unusual, unique film experience. And that's something that you tend to expect from Paul Thomas Anderson. As I said, David Fincher is probably my second favorite director. Paul Thomas Anderson is definitely my favorite living director that is working today. I love pretty much all his films. This one is just, it has such an auteur kind of point of view that you're really not sure whether you can grasp or not. It's hypnotic and very modern, but just unlike anything you've ever seen before. I relate it a lot to kind of very contemporary works of art or contemporary pieces of music, like of the 20th century, because, I don't know, when I think about music, maybe like The Rite of Spring, maybe, that is something that a lot of people didn't know how to comprehend because it's so dissonant and jarring and has a very grotesque sound in many ways. This movie has the same quality, but the central focus for sure is about obsession. That is one thing that you are for sure that I know is a running theme throughout the film. And it's a running theme through a lot of these movies that I've mentioned, I've noticed. But it's about greed and capitalism and what people are willing to do and what they're willing to sacrifice in order to get to the top. The main character in this is played by Daniel Day-Lewis. He plays Daniel Plainview, who is an oil man who's trying to get rich through the oil and the land that he owns. And even though that sounds like a very simple story, and sometimes people can think, you know, it sounds kind of boring, but it's anything but. The way that the film builds and the way that the film uses Daniel Plainview as the central focus is extremely powerful and very volatile. The character is very volatile and unpredictable. You never quite know what's going to happen with him. And Daniel Day-Lewis in this movie is one of the best performances I can think of in easily the last 10 years, if not more. What he does in this film is so outlandish and so different that it's something to behold, really it is. When I think of Daniel Plainview as the character, I think of characters, or I should say actors. When I think of Daniel Day-Lewis playing this role, I think of James Cagney, who's probably my favorite actor of all time, and I think of Jack Nicholson. These are other actors who, when they're playing their performances, they're very strange, very physical, but you're never really sure what you're supposed to feel as you're watching them. Are you supposed to laugh? Or are you supposed to feel bad for them? Are you supposed to be afraid of them? And I love actors that really take chances and are willing to kind of step outside of the box and do something very interesting instead of playing something straightforward and be really creative. And I feel the same way about Daniel Day-Lewis in this movie. He's very physical. Sometimes he's very kind of scary and intense. Sometimes he's even hilarious. There are times where you think he may as well just bust out into song and dance. He becomes so over the top. But at the same time, he's very real. I don't doubt him for a second. I feel that what he's doing on screen is very genuine, and he's not faking it. And the same with James Cagney or a Jack Nicholson. When I watch them, I think, this is supposed to happen. I'm not taken out of the film by their melodrama. I completely feel like what they're doing is meant to be organic and it's meant to happen the way it does. And I also think that Daniel Day-Lewis is, not only is his performance incredible, but it's the character itself that is just an amazing depth-filled character, almost Shakespearean in many ways. When I think of Daniel Plainview, I compare him even to Hamlet. I mean, I don't know if I should compare him to Hamlet, but I see a lot of similarities, even with Charles Foster Kane from Citizen Kane, the way that the character is trying to get his way to the top and he's very greedy. And also, even with Hamlet, you're not sure whether Hamlet is crazy or if he's sane. Same with Daniel Plainview. So there are a lot of very interesting dynamics and things that you see in a lot of, I guess, classical characters that I see mirrored in Daniel Plainview. But anyway, so the rest of the film, the soundtrack is one thing that I have to mention. The soundtrack is done by Johnny Greenwood. And it's just as shrill, just as experimental as the rest of the film is. Fits absolutely perfectly. One of my favorites. But the ending is something that I have to bring up, and I'm not going to spoil it, but I'll just say that I think it will be remembered in the same way that the ending to Blow Up, the 1960s Antonioni film, is remembered for. You know, the mime tennis match. And what I mean by that is that scene has been debated for so many years, you know, by so many critics and people, but a lot of people still don't know how to take it, whether or what it's supposed to mean. And I kind of feel the same way about the ending to There Will Be Blood. And I've seen the movie many, many times, but I'm not going to lie to you, I still do not know exactly how I feel about it. All I can tell you, I wish I had a more intelligent answer to give you for it, but all I can tell you is that the more that I watch it, the more I love it. As strange, as comedic, and as disturbing as it is, you know, some people think it goes too far into comedy or into madness, but I have to say, I think it completely works. But it's one of those things, again, you have to decide for yourself. If you've never seen it, watch the ending and kind of think, well, what do you think? What do you think that Paul Thomas Anderson is trying to say? What do you think that the actors are trying to do? But anyway, that's my number one film. Those are my top five. If you guys have any question or comments, or if you would like to tell me some of your favorites, please do not hesitate to comment below. And you can follow me on Twitter. I have the link at the bottom. And anyway, thank you very much for listening, and see you later.